basket. Of course, I was home. He didn't even want to hold it.
How are you?
Good evening.
How are you doing tonight?
Mark.
Yes, sir.
Nice to meet you, Mark.
Thank you. Nice to meet you, too.
How are you?
Alrighty, we're going to get started. Good evening and welcome to the City Council Candidate Forum. I'm Christie Haynes and I serve as the President of the Dawson County Chamber of Commerce. We are proud to host this evening's forum along with Dawson County News, VetcherNews.com, and Smoke Signals. And before we get started, if you will, please join me in standing for the pledge. Chamber's Destination 2020 plan, which is the strategic plan that outlines what the Chamber plans to accomplish over the next 3 years, is to continually advocate for our members and to be the voice of business for our community. According to the city's website, the 2017-2018 approved budget is just over $5 million. Of that budget, the portion of special purpose local option sales tax and local option sales tax, what we mostly know as lost and splossed, that is received by the city makes up 42.7% of the budget, which is just over $2.1 million. These funds are directly attributable to business and do not include any licensing fees or infrastructure investments or utilities that businesses also must pay to do business in the city. These businesses directly generate the income that pays for new sidewalks, improved park facilities, and this beautiful building that we're in today. As a resident of the city of Dawsonville, I am grateful to the business community for carrying this heavy load so that city residents do not have to pay any additional property tax. That being said, it is extremely important that we elect leaders that not only recognize the tremendous impact that our business community has, but also listen and work with the drivers of our local economy to ensure that we remain and even improve our entrepreneurial and business-friendly status. Before we get started, I would also like to express our appreciation to Dawson County High School for allowing us the use of this beautiful facility, which was paid for by SPLOST dollars. Please note that the Chamber does not endorse a particular party or particular candidates. We work diligently to ensure that tonight's forum is fair to the participants and informative to our members and citizens. Questions were predetermined by the committee and were taken from questions that were submitted by Chamber members. If you are unable to stay for the entire forum or would like to share this forum with other residents, the video will be posted to our Chamber's YouTube and Facebook pages tomorrow. For this forum, each candidate will have 3 minutes to introduce themselves, 2 minutes to respond to each question, and 2 minutes for a closing statement. Candidates have not previously seen the questions. Our candidates are seated in alphabetical order by last name. Opening statements will be given in alphabetical order, and then each following question will be answered by the next candidate in alphabetical order. Our panelists who will be asking the questions are Allie Dean from Dawson County News, Bill Johnson from FetchYourNews.com, and Denise Ray from Smoke Signals. Our timekeepers are Melissa Maiden and Kristen Graves. Kristen will hold up warning signs when you have 1 minute left, 30 seconds left, and when your time has run out. Kristen, you want to demonstrate that? Can all the candidates see that okay? Great. We will strictly enforce the time limit, so please make sure to stick to that. And also, if the audience will please hold applause until the end of the forum. We're gonna get through this pretty quickly so everyone can get back to their homes. We're gonna begin with opening statements. You each have 3 minutes, and we will begin with Mark French. Mark.
Well, thank you. First of all, I'd like to thank our host for sponsoring this event tonight. I know it takes a great deal of effort to do so, and it's greatly appreciated. But more importantly, I'd like to thank you all for taking time out of your lives to be here this evening and allow us an opportunity to share a little bit about ourselves and what we envision for Dawsonville moving in the future. As I said, my name is Mark French. While I'm not a native of Dawsonville, I grew up in a little town not far from here. You may have heard of it. It's called Dahlonega. While there, I attended North Georgia College, as it was known at that time. I earned a bachelor's degree in business administration and with a major in finance. I began a nearly 20-year career in public service when I accepted a position with the Lumpkin County Board of Commissioners Finance Office. My tenure there for the past 10 years was acting as their budgeting grant analyst. In doing that, I had an opportunity to work with every department to understand their needs, both financially and otherwise, and how to help them plan for the future. The main challenge I see for Dawsonville moving forward is to engage more participation from those that we're here to serve. In doing so, the first thing I would like to do is make sure these meetings are more open to the public. I would like to see the website updated so that those who have a different work schedule than I do will at least have an opportunity to see what's going on in their community and to know, do they need to take time off maybe from work to be there if it's something that's very dear to them. The second thing we need to do is to work together with the county government and state agencies to begin a more aggressive revitalization plan for downtown. I believe that could be the springboard for our future success. And it would also allow us an opportunity to have controlled, managed, and quality growth moving forward. And with that being said, I would appreciate your consideration.
Ms. Smith.
Again, I would like to reiterate my thanks to the panel. Terminal and to the Chamber for allowing us to be here tonight. My name is Angie Smith, and I am a lifelong resident here in the city limits in the county. Also, I have been married to my husband Scott for 21 years. I have two children, a 13 and a 9-year-old, who are all students at Dawson County Schools, one at Robinson Elementary and one at the junior high. My roots here in the city limits go back much longer than I have been here, four generations in the city limits of entrepreneurs and businessmen and women here. The county probably much longer than that, but for the city limits of four generations. My great-grandmother moved here with her family in the early 1900s, and they also ran businesses in the downtown, of which we still own the buildings, and we still commercially rent those. I am extremely proud to be from the city of Dawsonville and Dawson County as well. We all have the option as we grow and mature to leave and build roots somewhere else. I've chosen to stay here in this community and hopefully be a positive influence on those people who live here with me and work here with me. I also agree that city and the county cannot be separated. They are one and the same, in my opinion. And when I talk about citizens, I also am meaning citizens of this county as well. They are extremely important to me. And the decisions that I make on council and those kinds of things are always in consideration of those who live in the county as well. I also want to work hard to see this community grow and prosper, but to me, our heritage is extremely important. We have to remember where we came from and who came before us in order to lay the groundwork to be successful in the future. Service with integrity is a goal of mine. Honesty to a fault is what you'll get from me, and that's always my goal. It's not always about the end result. It's not always about the list of accomplishments, but it's about how that work was done, and the honesty and the integrity that you carry yourself with means a great deal to me. And I always want to honor my family and serve with that, with honesty and with them in mind. It's a lost art, I think, and I think that's something that's extremely important.
Thank you. Mike Sosebee.
My name is Mike Sosebee. I'm a member of the City Council. I'm seeking re-election. My wife, Mary, is with us. We have two sons, three grandsons. I've served in the United States Army, a member of the American Legion, and I'm retired from business. It is an honor to serve on the City Council, and I'm seeking your vote. That's it.
Thank you. Mr. Tolson.
So I've lived in Dawsonville since 2009, when I was assigned to the 5th Ranger Training Battalion in Dahlonega. I was fortunate enough to complete my 20 years there at Camp Merrill, living here in Dawsonville. The Army gives you an opportunity when you retire, some of you may know this, to pack up, and they'll move you wherever you want to go, and or they'll give you a generous sum of money to do that yourself. And we turned that down because we knew we were home. I have a daughter that's started kindergarten here in the Dawson County school system, and at the time she was in sixth grade and doing very well. As a matter of fact, 3 months after we retired, she took her SATs, 12 years old, and was invited to Duke University as part of the Duke TIPS program. And the reason I mention that is that's a testament to Dawson County Schools and the folks that were part of the school system at the time and now, and that's one of the reasons we decided to stay. The other reason we decided to stay while I was here, we had two additions to the family. I have two more boys since we moved here, 3 and 5 year old, and Dawsonville is essentially their world right now. And as a parent, I'm sure most folks would agree that We want to do whatever we can to influence our children's world in a positive way, and that's what I'm going to attempt to do here. I mean, the question in a lot of people's minds is, why do I feel like I'm able to do that? So, aside from the 20 years of service, I also have a master's degree in healthcare administration. It's a business degree specific to healthcare. I utilize that now. After retirement, I started managing a medical group, and the Cleveland Medical Group, not too far from here. As a manager, the evaluation of business needs and planning and forecasting the needs for the future and preparing for the execution and execution of those goals, as well as follow-up, which is something I think we'll talk a little bit more about tonight, is a big part of that. And I retired as a senior non-commissioned officer as well, and what that means is I was fortunate enough to take part in a number of short and long-term planning sessions throughout the years, and I believe that experience can be can assist the council. As well as a number of military schools, the goals of those schools, some of you may know that utilizing your decision-making processes and problem-solving techniques, as well as introducing a little bit of common sense into those decision-making processes, is part of what they train us on. And I hope to utilize all of that to the best of my ability to make this a better city. And again, I ask for your vote. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll have Allie Dean from Dawson County News begin with our questions.
Our first question is, beyond attendance of city council meetings, what do you believe the role of a city council member should be? We'll begin with Angie Smith.
As someone who has spent the last 4 years trying to figure that out, I think the role of the city council member is really whatever needs to be done. Sometimes you need to be on the ground. You need to go visit somewhere. You need to do your research. You need to read, follow up, meet with city employees, talk about steps going forward, talk to county officials, county employees. I don't think you can put one hat on and say that covers it, that some days you're on the phone for hours, it seems like, and some days you are more normal in your routine. Other days, you have council meetings, you have other meetings that come up during the day, and it just cannot be a one-size-fits-all. And each commissioner, each council member will probably do it differently. You'll have different answers to that, but my short answer is you have to do whatever's necessary.
Thank you. Mr. Sosebee?
Beyond attendance of city council meetings, what do you believe the role of a city council member should be?
So beyond actually going to the meetings, what else would you feel the responsibilities of a city council member?
Actually, we are representatives of people, and we need to communicate with the people that we represent, and we do the work for them, not for ourselves. And, basically, that's it.
Thank you. Mr. Tolson?
I think that aside from helping your teammates on the council make informed decisions for the city and its members, I think that being a liaison for the city is really important. I've heard a lot of other communities, members of the communities come and visit here, and I've spoken to a number of people, not just citizens that sell their city while they're here. They talk about folks from Milton or Covington or Cumming. They talk about how great their city is, and I believe that as we travel, our responsibilities don't stop at the city borders. I think that, we all know that bringing business to our city, bringing tourism benefits everybody, and I think that would be one of obviously many other responsibilities aside from attending meetings.
Thank you. Mr. French?
Well, I believe that the title of city council member loses a little bit of something. I think the title should be more accurately public servant. And in order to be a good servant to those that you represent, requires one to listen more than they talk. And I believe that's why we have two ears and only one mouth. But in doing so, being accessible to everyone, hearing opinions which may differ from your own, in order to work together and build a consensus among the council, civic organizations in the community, and the citizens to ensure that what is best for everybody is being done. So I believe that's the principal role.
And the next question is, governments have an equal obligation to be fiscally responsible and to provide services to citizens. Currently, the city has a very large fund balance in reserves. Do you believe this is the best utilization of taxpayer dollars? And if not, what kind of capital or infrastructure improvements and services do you think the city should be providing that it is not already? And this question goes to Mike Sosebee.
I'll be honest with you, buddy. I have a problem hearing, and I just heard part of what you said.
Okay. Well, I'll try and repeat it. Hopefully, it'll be a bit louder and won't get a feedback. Governments have an equal obligation to be fiscally responsible and to provide services to citizens. Currently, the city has over 100% fund balance in reserves. Do you believe this is the best utilization of taxpayer dollars? And if not, what kind of capital or infrastructure improvements and services do you think the city should be providing that it is not already?
I believe I'll pass on that because I'm going to know.
Okay, then the next question will go to Steve.
Yeah, I think I believe Ms. Smith is next. I hate to cut you off. Is it okay?
No, I think so.
Yeah, so as far as the reserves, I think that, obviously that was great. It's great to have reserves. I think that it wasn't too long ago where we didn't have that. So, I think, the people of the city, the government officials should be applauded for that. As far as what we do with the reserves, we want to use the funds that, there's obviously other ways to get funds. We know that there's grants and loans. I think obviously before we take a loan out, we should look at the funds that we have available. As far as other infrastructure projects, I've talked about selling the city. I think that going out and being a marketing representative for the city requires something to market. So I think that, building a downtown that's welcoming, I think that we've started that project. I think that we might, I think there's some room to grow when it comes to making and navigating the city, for instance, something that someone can park at and visit a number of venues, recreational opportunities, restaurants and whatnot. Maybe spend some of those funds to supplement some of the businesses that want to set up shop here, and of course that the council and other members of the city believe that it would best benefit the city.
Thank you. Mark?
Well, the Georgia Government Finance Officers Association recommends local governments maintain between a 15% to a 25% of their annual operating budget in what they call a fund balance, or more specifically, an unreserved fund balance. What that means is that you have an opportunity to spend that pretty much on whatever it needs to be spent upon. Sometimes fund balance can be reserved and it's earmarked for a special thing. I believe I would not be willing to go below an 18% in terms of fund balance. That way you have a little rainy day money in case something bad happens. I know, for example, when I worked in Lumpkin County, we had an ice storm, and a little bit of fund balance sure was nice to help us in the interim do some debris removal on the many county roads. But since the city doesn't really have that much of an issue in that area, I think some of those funds could be used to help dress up downtown. It can be used to introduce more parks into the community. The new sidewalk is a very nice addition to the city. I think we could use that as a springboard to provide more services to our citizens without increasing their long-term obligation to maintain those facilities.
Thank you. Angie?
I believe that in our attempts in the last few years to save money, it hasn't been for the purpose to just save money and to sit on. We knew 5 years ago, that we had a lot of projects that we needed to do. Main Street Park was one that was brought up to council. The downtown revitalization is another one. Those are projects that, even though we have SPLOST dollars at this point, that doesn't cover what the total cost or the total bill of that would be. So we also knew that the city was growing. We knew that we would need more staff members, different things like that, that would eventually eat up those costs or eat up that fund balance, that excess. We've got things on the horizon that need to be addressed, the Dawsonville bypass, different things that are going to take an extreme amount of coordination and cooperation and money to do. And so I think when you look at the projects that we have on the horizon, the money that we've saved is not going to be saved forever, that we do have and have had, and that's toward great leadership in City Hall to see that and to see that what's coming, and to to be able to recognize that and to say, let's save now and in order to spend in the future what we need to, instead of nickel and diming everything and spending to that 15-18% fund balance limit and not having anything for major improvements, major water system improvements, sewer system improvements that we're looking at in the future. And I think that over the past 5 years, the time that I have been at City Hall, that's one of our greatest assets, that we have had the planning and the resources now we have in place to give a great start for those things.
Thank you.
Dawsonville's city charter currently allows 3 city council members to vote to remove a mayor. Should the 3 council members have the power to override the citizens' votes, or should the charter be amended? We'll start with Steve Tolson.
I believe that the members of the city council were elected for a reason. They are supposed to be representative of the people. With that said, I think that certain decisions that are made should be offered up to the people. There are many circumstances that I think the council should have the opportunity to make a call based on them being elected and being representatives of the people. But I think a situation of that nature, I really do feel like when I talk about infusing a little common sense into decision making, I think maybe that those types of decisions with that level, that gravity should be offered up to the people.
Mark.
Well, it occurs to me that just because something is legal doesn't always mean that it's right. I believe that in being a good public servant, one should listen to the community, seek their input so that you can make a better decision. Perhaps it would be better to remove a mayor, perhaps it would not. But I think it merits evaluation of all the facts, not merely hearsay.
Angie?
There are a lot of things that city council members, county commissioners, they're faced with, they're brought to, that you operate the absolute best way that you know how. You operate on what you have in front of you. Now, we can always have a conversation about how things need to be changed, if they do, ordinances that need to be changed, different ways that people or that our governments, whether city, county, federal, anything, that need to be changed. But the fact of the matter is, when you are sitting in office, you have a set of rules that guide you. And the set of rules that guide you at the time is what you are charged with fulfilling. And we can have conversations. There are things that people disagree with in those conversations. We can certainly have conversations about bylaws and ordinances and city charters that need to be changed. That's something I believe that as a council member you have to be open to do that, certainly. But I also know from experience that when you are in the council meeting or you are preparing for that meeting, you don't have the luxury to say, well, what if it wasn't like this? What if it was some other way?
Mike?
You know, I think that we are representatives of the people, and we need a lot of input from the people to make the decisions, and not the four members that sit in front of you trying to make all the decisions. And, you know, like she says, we got rules that we got to go by, and basically, that's...
Christie, do you mind if I give Mr. Sosebee a copy of my question?
Sure.
Is this the question here?
All right. So the question is, in your opinion, what are the biggest challenges for new and existing city business owners? What are your plans for addressing these issues? We'll begin with Mark.
Well, number one is finding a good location. I think we all know that's key to a good business. I believe in partnering with the Chamber of Commerce, the Downtown Development Authority. We can partner with them, and in doing so, encourage quality growth, the type of businesses we would like to see in the community. That's the chief thing. But in doing so, I think you will reach a point where we have to make sure that we have the infrastructure to support those new businesses. I certainly would not want to encourage someone to open up operations only to have the inability to serve them appropriately in terms of their water and their streets. So I think it's a multifaceted aspects which need to be examined from a broad base by partnering with your community leaders.
Okay, Angie Smith.
I believe that we have a good structure in city limits for businesses, but I do believe that there are ways to improve what we offer to them as far as the services. For example, parking is always an issue with our businesses and has been the topic of much conversation when it comes to conversations about the downtown revitalization. The new sidewalks and new streetscapes and things have their positives, but they also bring some challenges. Parking is one of those challenges. Infill is another challenge that we have. Once we do move in partnership with Downtown Development Authorities and Chambers of Commerce, and hopefully we have tried in the past to have downtown merchant associations which start off strong and kind of fizzle due to lack of attendance, those kinds of things. You know, we want to hear from those people in businesses but they have problems with their physical and with getting people to come into their shops. It's the one thing to have a quality shop, but do we have the base citizenry that will shop or eat in our restaurants? And that's always a way that we look for help from the chamber and different things for ways to promote those businesses as well. Property owners are a huge either help or hindrance to our business owners as well, and having buy-in from those people is huge for success of our businesses also.
Mike Sosebee.
I think the city really doesn't do a good job of trying to attract businesses, to be honest with you. You know, it's like Angie says, we have a terrible traffic problem, we have no place to park, and about the only thing that the city has is the hair shops, restaurants, and food places, and the hardware store. And I've been here all my life, and you know, I don't know of any business other than the poultry processing plant here that's even tried to come into the city.
Steve?
I would say that with any business, establishing or realizing the type of business that attracts both local and visiting customers is probably one of the larger issues, particularly with a new business. You know, as I understand it, based on speaking with some of the business owners within the city, there's also some issues, potentially cumbersome aspects of policy as far as expanding your business. You know, once you have established a business that, which we all know is a difficult thing to do, that attracts, customers. How do we How do we establish policies that encourage the continued growth of those businesses? And also, of course, it's mentioned that partnering with organizations such as the Chamber and, other small groups that are within the city, groups of businesses that they communicate with each other. I just spoke with a number of businesses before I came in here today. I think everybody knows that encouraging growth in one aspect, this is a small city, encouraging growth in one aspect of the city benefits, growth in another. I think that reevaluating policies for expansion, assisting with the roads to bring in more customers and working together as a business community.
And the next question will first go to Angie Smith. Advocates of consolidated government purport the efficiency of a combined government. Would you favor the consolidation of our city and county governments, and why or why not?
I would not. As much as I love our county commissioners who are in attendance tonight and others in the county, I have to believe that there's something to be said for accountability for different sections of our citizenry. And combining, I know that it has been done successfully in other places. Some probably would say that there was a lot of heartburn that went into that consolidation, but I believe that a city functions and can respond better to its citizens than a combined government can. I have nothing but the utmost respect for those who serve in the county, and I love county citizens just as much. I am a county citizen. I think that's what a lot of people forget, is that just because your residence is in the city limits, you are also a resident of that county in which you live, in which your city is as well. So I do see that some people think that combining is the best option, but I think the more hands that you can offer help with and the more availability to smaller groups is better, and that's what I see the county and the city. Now, do I think that they should have a working relationship? Absolutely. There's nothing better for our citizens than county and city that work together. But should we be separate and be our own entities? Absolutely.
Thank you. Mike Sosebee.
I don't think that will happen in no time in the near future, combining with the county. We could work with the county in a lot of different projects and things like that, but I just don't think that would work out.
Thank you. Steve Tolson.
Yeah, I think that, it's my philosophy that, governing at the lowest level is extremely important the closer you get to the people, right? I don't think that consolidation of county and city is the right direction, but I do obviously think that a good relationship, one of the things that I've heard continuously while talking to citizens is that they'd like to see a closer relationship between the county and the city. Now, there are areas that I think we should consider, not necessarily consolidation, I don't necessarily like that word, but I do think that, potentially utilities, for instance. We have an increase in population that's coming very soon. Speaking with the city planning director, we have, just short of 500 houses that are going to be built in the next 2 years. I think that the county could help substantially in water and sewage, for instance.
Mark French.
I would certainly be willing to consider that option. However, in order to make a wise decision, it would be prudent to have all the facts. And sitting here, it occurs to me that one of the areas which it could be beneficial is the periodic renegotiation of the split between the local option sales tax and the SPLOST money between the city and the county. Sometimes those negotiations can become rather aggressive, and I've even seen them progress onto a court level. I'm not suggesting that would happen here, but that's one thing that would be mitigated by combining the governments. But again, you have to look to the debt structure. Who gets what? Who answers to whom? How are the Board of Commissioners districts, assuming it falls under the board, would they be represented at large, or would they have specific districts for which they are responsible and accountable to? So I think there are many things that could be looked at. I would like to see a study and to speak with people who've been through the process. I agree with Ms. Smith in that there have been numerous cases throughout the state where it has been beneficial. There have been some cases where perhaps it wasn't as beneficial. And when you're representing the people, you've got to put your personal opinions aside and do what's best for everyone.
Knowing that not all citizens are able to attend city council meetings, in what ways do you think the city of Dawsonville currently acts as a transparent government entity? And in addition, what other improvements to transparency, such as streaming city meetings on the city's website, would you support? And we begin with Mark French.
As I mentioned in my opening statement, one of the things I would like to do is to foster more participation from those that we represent. One way of doing that is through amending the county's website. That's not the end all be all to everything, but think about it. If you're planning on going somewhere or moving somewhere, probably the first step you're going to be is to research them on the internet. Look at their website, see what services they have, what is their tax base, what is their plan for growth. These are things which I think could be addressed on the website. Beyond that, I think it would be wise to have more than just the city council's agenda and their minutes reflected on the website. I think it would be a good idea for every item that they're going to be discussing to be there and available for the public to view well before the meeting takes place. That way they know if they need to be there.
Angie Smith.
I would say that there is always room for improvement, but as far as I am concerned, we always look for public input. It's always important to us to hear from the public, and I think that that we have gone out of our way at times to be accessible. Personally, I almost would rather discuss personally, one-on-one and things like that. Meetings are always open. Everything that we do is open to anyone, for anyone to see. We do give out our agenda and our agenda items a week ahead of time. Everything is set and passed out the Wednesday before a Monday meeting, so that people can see exactly what we're going to discuss. We also discuss it at a work session. We have work sessions before the first of the month meetings, so things are always out there and they're available, and our city staff does a great job on our website and on keeping us current with things like that. Is there room for improvement? Probably always. Well, I know that there have been times that we have posted audio of our council meetings. I don't know exactly that that's updated all the time. That could probably be done a little bit better. But government must be transparent. We've got to be accessible at any time for any question, and we've got to have it at our fingertips. And I would say that that we do a pretty good job of that.
Mike Sosebee.
I don't see a problem with it. I think you should put the agenda and the meetings on the website and give the people a fair amount of time to go over it and ask questions. And, you know, most people work for a living and they don't have time to come in to these meetings that we have. And I really don't see a big problem with it.
Mr. Tolson?
Yeah, I think that everybody agrees that transparency is important. I think that, as I speak to folks, I've mentioned this a little bit beforehand, the reason we're not getting a big turnout in the city when it comes to voting is because people don't know what goes on in the city a lot of times. And it's really not necessarily a lack of it being available. But again, it all goes back to marketing. We need to, I think live streaming is a great idea. And I've talked about that in the past. I think Mark is right. And we should offer up, an agenda early on for the citizens to take a look at and decide whether they want to be there. And I'll tell you, it's not an easy thing, particularly if you're employed, to make it to a 4 o'clock work session or a 5 o'clock city meeting. I would love to see those changed as well. But if that's not the case, I think that offering it in a media format that's accessible by obviously as many people that are willing to look at it is important. That'd be great.
All right, now we'll move into closing statements. I want to apologize for the unintentional error in the order last time. That was completely our fault, not on our question askers. But we will begin with closing statements. We have 2 minutes apiece, and we will begin with Angie Smith.
Again, I would like to say thank you for the opportunity to be here. I love the city of Dawsonville and Dawson County and its citizens. It has been a great pleasure and a great honor for me to serve over the past term. And there are a lot of things that we started. There are a lot of things that need to be brought to fruition. And I would ask that, say that if re-elected, that would be my mission, is to forward as much of the city's plans as possible, and to be as accessible and to be as reachable to all citizens as possible. I do believe that we are at a time when great growth is expected. And there's a lot to be required of us, of your city leaders, of your county leaders, there to whom much is given, much is required. And I believe that I have been given much by being a resident and a citizen here. And it's just a service thing with me. I just want to, because of the stake that I have in this city and in my hometown, I want to be of service. There's not one specific issue that stands out to me. They're all important. All citizens are important, and every aspect of this government is important to me, and I look forward to being able to continue the work that we have started. Thank you.
Thank you.
We have much to be proud of at Dawsonville. No city taxes, revitalization downtown Dawsonville, new sidewalks, beautification, beautiful city hall, Racing Hall of Fame, a good local business community, and I have been a part of the team of the city council which has helped bring this together. We have a good quality of life, and we are moving forward as we should.
So I didn't get a chance to thank you all for coming, so thank you. Thank you to the chamber and to the local news outlets for coming out and supporting us. I would reiterate, and it's been said a number of times, you know, the city's at a crossroads, and I believe that, you know, there's been some planning. There's been a lot of talk about where we need to be or where we're going to be in the next 5 years, and, you know, as I stated before, we have, there's going to be an explosion of population, and I believe that, you know, we need folks on the city council that are willing to lean forward and to do the follow-up and to apply some common sense to some of the policies. And you know, I believe that this is a, you know, it's a unique city, and it's a city of people that care about their neighbors genuinely. They're proud of their country, and you know, everybody in one way or another looks for the opportunity to serve, to do the choose the hard right over the easy wrong. And I would ask that you elect me and allow me to do that for you.
Thank you. Mark French.
Again, I'd like to thank everyone for taking time out of your lives to be here with us tonight and to be patient and listen to us. I'd also like to thank my fellow candidates here. It's been really nice up here. There's been no tension at all. We've had some nice conversations before the meeting started, and I enjoyed that. But moving more toward the point, with me, what you see is what you get. I've got a finance background, which tends to make me a little conservative in my views on spending money, but I believe we can invest in some quality areas. I believe the city has a good basis to do so. I believe that we can open up the meetings a little bit more. I'd like to introduce some public comment sections, both at a work session, following after they've discussed everything there. I'd like to see the public have an opportunity to share their opinions on what they were talking about. I'd also like to see some public comment on their voting sessions before they vote, so that you once more have an opportunity to say your piece before a vote is cast. So I think in doing that, combining with some improvements to the website, we can really become truly accessible to everyone all the time. Thank you.
Thank you. If y'all will, please join me in a round of applause for all the candidates and your panels. We are so grateful to Dawson County News, FetcherNews.com, and Smoke Signals for co-hosting us this evening and for being panelists. A few quick reminders. The last day to register to vote is October 10th. So if you're not registered, we're not going to make you raise your hand, but we would love for you to go register. I hope that you grabbed one of these sheets when you came in. If we have extras, please take them home with you and encourage anyone you know that's a resident to go ahead and go register to vote. Advance voting begins Monday, October 16th, and you can vote Monday through Friday at the Dawson County Board of Elections, which is right over there by the cemetery, from 8 a.m. until 5 p.m. Election day is November 7th, so if you're a traditionalist like me and want to vote on election day, that is November 7th. And you can view this forum on the Chamber's YouTube page, but we'll also put it on our social media different websites, and as well as our Dawson County Chamber website, so that'll be up tomorrow. We ask you to encourage everyone you know to vote and to vote for candidates that you believe support the needs and issues of our local business community. We really appreciate you taking the time out of your schedule to be here tonight, and please call on us if we can do anything to support you or your local business. Thank you.